In the 1980s, a new craze labeled breakdancing, but more accurately called b-boying, invaded the UK from America. Growing ever more popular stateside, no one could have anticipated the impact this dance form, lifted from hip-hop culture, would have on the disaffected youth of Britain, giving them a voice and a reason to shout and be heard. Only a few British b-boys had it within themselves to take things to a new level that would challenge the world scene. This is the story of an individual, inspired by early old-school breakers, who made an insurmountable contribution to the phenomenon of b-boying.
There's not many people like him that were living the dance as he was.
EVO, man.
EVO.
B-boy EVO. Where do I start?
He had it all. Like, he had the power, he had finesse, he had style.
Just on a completely different level.
It was dynamite. All good breaking is.
We just were really inspired by like what he did, you know, and it kind of made us what we do today possible.
It's gonna inspire a movement.
Everyone's gonna say it, but I'll say it was incredible, you know what I mean?
It wasn't just his like incredible power moves, it was his style as well.
I was like, wow, that's crazy.
Great storytelling.
I always try to be as fast as him, but it was impossible.
For me, he's like the Tasmanian devil.
Big inspiration for everyone.
Mad evolution style, old school b-boy, ripping shit all over the world.
Became known for his explosive dance style and presence. Steering shy of the politics of b-boying meant nobody would ever get to hear the opinions of this enigmatic b-boy. What and who inspired him to start dancing? How did he approach the dance? And what was his battle mentality? All became a common question amongst the community of dancers lucky enough to witness his contribution. Now, we open the floodgates on what drove this modest individual from a humble background to become a highly competitive and outstandingly original b-boy that smashed the world by winning 3 titles consecutively, amongst other highly coveted awards.
I started dancing back in about 1983, quickly. Got into my first crew, which was the Ultimate Street Rockers in Manchester.
If you could just throw down in a circle, get the crowd to go wild, then you'd gain so much respect for a 13-14 year old guy, and that was incredible.
I just bumped myself up really quick with reputation, got into Reflex Rockers. The crew that I wanted to be in was Street Machine.
Everyone used to hang around Arndale Centre. Arndale Centre on a Saturday was where you had to be. Street Machine, right, exactly, but Street Machine, their area of the Arndale Centre in Manchester, near Halley Square, was outside JD Sports in Manchester City Centre. So if you ever wanted to find anyone from Street Machine or any of the guys, that's where they'd be. So every Saturday, everyone would meet up. The whole Arndale Centre was full of, you know, hip-hop people, hip-hop guys, all watching out. So there was always someone walking around with a big stereo. And it was a case, we'd just take over Halley Square. Some guys would stick a stereo down, and that's it. We'd just end up breakdancing in Halley Square. security guards trying to chase like 100 people out, forcing 100 people to go out.
You used to see these guys coming from their area to a club, which was Stretford Civic Theatre at the time, where all the battles would be every weekend. And you saw these guys coming running, jumping over fences, all in the blue Tashini tracksuits. And as a young kid, you look at these and think, that I want to be in that crew.
You got to remember, we were like, I was what, 15, 16 years old. A lot of the guys were much older. And to walk into a club, any part of Manchester, or any part of Salford, or Cheetham Mill, and to walk in, you know, knowing that you're, in 10 minutes' time you'll take over this club, was fantastic. People like Jason and Neverson and Cam and Rhino as well. They were just so cocky about it. Didn't matter, you know, don't care who you are.
I worked my way up to that crew. Basically, they just took me on board.
The Street Machine were always looking for the right. Who's the next best thing? Who's the next guy coming up? And it was the same with Lee and Ever. You knew no matter what someone did on the dance floor, that you had someone who could cover it and do it. 10 times better as well. So having that backup, you know, people like Emma and Lee and Jason and all the guys, it was just like, you know, we could pretty much conquer everything.
Some of the when the battles went off there, it was dark clubs, guys just clear a circle, swinging a leather jacket round, and it'd go off big style. It was real beef between crews, because it was different areas, different parts of Manchester. The atmosphere was electric back then. It was crazy. It was close to fighting at the end.
Me and Marvin were doing this routine, and one of their guys came up. We both did exactly the same move, but then he grabbed hold of my throat on the dance floor, because he literally grabbed hold of my throat.
In 1987, Evo stopped dancing. The scene was fading away in Britain, and with it, competition, particularly for the better b-boys. The general belief was that the scene had died. Evo decided to pursue other physically challenging pursuits.
A friend of mine gave me a magazine in 91, and there was an article in there with some dancers from Runcorn, which was always rocking tough.
You just have to dig around and learn, you know, who was there about Evo and Second to None, Tim Twist, and all the original cats.
I had no idea that anybody was still doing the dance, so straight away I contacted these guys, started doing swipes in my bedroom. I'd been up there, met Tim and Tom from Always Rocking Tough. They'd heard of me from way back in the day, from Street Machine. They showed me a tape of Storm, Swift, the European scene, and I just thought to myself, I can compete with that. And that was it. I was like a dog with a bone after that. It was just like, I can do this.
First time I saw EVO was a Battle of the Year. I think it was in 93, and I was judging the Battle of the Year. And in the last battle, he mainly went against my brother Speedy. You know, they went back and forth all the time. And I was amazed by his power, by, you know, the way he was combining things, you know, the dynamics that he created within the style, you know. He was showing different ways of, you know, everything was just in one flow. Everything was just so spontaneous as well. You know, like when he was going up from windmills to 1 and 90s and stuff like that, everything was so fluent that, yeah, I've never seen anything like that before. Actually, so, you know, like I think, yeah, up until this day.
Always rocking tough. Basically got invited over. For the competition, just to rep from the UK side, because there wasn't any other crews, I don't think. So we went over there, got to show our stuff, and luckily we won it. Germany definitely carried on and helped the scene grow over there, the b-boy scene, the whole hip-hop scene. There was a lot of good jams going on over in Germany.
When we went to clubs and stuff, a lot of people thought that we were battling. It was just like, it was a natural exchange. It was a healthy competition, you know? It's not like people these days when they get to it with all grief and stuff, you know? It was always a natural competition and always respected, you know? And he knew that we weren't sleeping, and I knew that he wasn't sleeping, you know? So we knew, like, okay, next time we're gonna see each other, you know, let's see. You know, if you practice on something or not, you know? And it was, but it, for him, for me, it was like, you know, I always tried to be as fast as him, but it was impossible. It was impossible. I mean, of course, part of it is because he's a bit shorter,
yeah.
You know, but hey, man, it was incredible, you know? It's like the dynamics he had and the speed and everything. Like, I've never seen any b-boy like that again ever since.
Once we got out there and met them, them guys were great. They just took us in and they trained like animals, and it was something for us to keep up to. We had to keep up with them. Rocking tough. I kind of ventured up to Scotland. I met up with two guys, Brian and Archie. Jam in Livingston, various dancers came over from Germany, including Storm and Swift, who we'd met previously at Battle of the Year. We'd all been training all day, the day before as well, and our bodies were aching. To Storm and Swift, you guys, you're like machines, you just keep going, don't ever get tired. And they were like, we were thinking the same about you.
In Scotland, actually, that was one of the few times where we could really hang out together, because I think Swift and me, we stayed there for almost a week. Inspired me so much. about how to combine things and his power. You know, the way he went into his moves and he came out, everything was so spontaneous, you know, which I loved. You know, like that sometimes he wouldn't even look at the floor, he would just jump into his moves. And we were like, what was that? I wish it was more often, and he was, you know, I'll miss him.
From us creating the Floor Freaks, from the jams in Livingston, we travelled to Germany because we got an invite for the Battle of the Year. We hooked up with Freeze, who was over there at the time, Freeze from Throwdown Rockers, who was a good friend. We decided to jump in together and enter the competition because we didn't think there was a UK crew at the time.
I got Battle of the Year 96 when I started breaking, and it was, not only was the whole video out of this world, but it's the first coverage I saw of EVO pretty seriously getting down with Floor Freaks.
It was me, Archie and Brian, the Floor Freaks. Freeze from Throwdown was over at the same time. We all got on well anyway, good friends, we've been to various jams together, and just decided to basically enter the comp because there was nobody from the UK entering in 96.
That was really one of the first inspirations I had, but seeing EVO on that, it was just like a small clip, and I was like, okay, who's this guy? Because he's pretty dope. But then it was like, he's from the UK, so I'm thinking, all right, and I didn't see much more until I got UK Champs 96, and then that was like a different thing altogether, because really holding it down was like second to none and EVO.
You know, like, for some B-boys, you go, oh, he's got sick footwork, or oh, he's got sick power moves, or oh, you know, there might be one thing that attracts you to them. But by EVO, it was like, just everything he'd done, like, it all fitted perfectly.
This guy's just formidable. People don't understand over here in London and in England what this guy done.
My favourite solo battle was probably the UK Championships.
Watching him at the UK Champs years back, you know, just seeing how he danced, how he was really swift and really fast and had good sweeps, and he had a nice character. I liked the way he used to dance.
He was just on a different level. I mean, second to none were as well, but that first competition, 96, to anyone who went there was just like, oh my God, these guys are just incredible. The championship 3 years in a row. He's the only person to win it consecutively, only person to win it three times. You know what I mean? He's like, the record is there. I don't think anyone is even going to touch that, to be honest. I mean, crew wise obviously the Koreans have taken it three times, but he did it solo three times.
It goes by so quick at the time and you don't realize, well, looking back at it, they were the highlights, traveling, the tours.
They did the Prodigy tour as well, yeah. You know, and that was like, that was a real big move, and that was, the Prodigy came to the first B-Boy Championship 96, and that's when they saw him, and then 97 they came back, and then that was when I think Liam asked them to go on tour with him, and EVO was like, yeah, we've got to take Lacey as the DJ and that.
The Prodigy tour, it was kind of the height of my B-Boying career. Liam from the Prodigy was a big fan. A b-boy in any way, he's an ex-dancer himself, asked me to get some guys together, which we already had, which was the Floor Freaks, which was Brian, Archie and myself, and we got Tufton Twist and the late James Lacey as the DJ. That was just crazy. We just got, you know, the chance to see what it was like to live the lifestyle of a celeb, a star.
I mean, I got to chill with him a few times. We went to Japan, myself, him and Tim Twist, and also we went to Iceland as well. it wasn't just his like incredible power moves, it was his style as well, you know, the way he incorporated little things like the Fred Astaire stuff, and you know, it was just flavour, mad flavour, and always just his, on his own thing.
His explosives, he didn't expect to see, didn't know what to come came next.
I've never seen anyone else move like Evo, that's the thing, and it was like, everything was inch perfect. It would just all look so right.
When you touch the floor, he does something, you think he's gonna go in one direction, but he doesn't, he goes the other way, flip up, goes small ball and pop into a big ass move and stuff, you know?
When you throw something in that's unexpected, it doesn't look like it's something you're gonna be capable of doing, going from one direction to the other, or from a backspin, then hitting straight up into a 90, it's explosive, it's like, whoa.
He has the quickness, the musicality he has, the way he puts everything together, and it's so sharp and dynamic, it's brilliant.
He's built to b-boy, basically. He's compact, powerful, and that reflects in his dance. I mean, he was doing moves which, you know, weren't really thought about at that time.
He was doing combos 13, 14 years ago, which you still don't see done today. As I say, backspin to 90. Who does that now? Who does that?
As a comparison, you had Acer from Second to None. Evo and Acer always looked very similar to me in their approach to the dance. And visually, you know, it was difficult to separate the two because they both had that kind of funky power and very, very fast sort of technical manoeuvres.
I got on really well with Second to None. Been down there and jammed with them plenty of times, and we used to always hang out because Acer, at the time, he was probably one of the best in the UK.
Man, I was inspired by EVO, man. Like, EVO, you know, he was around the time when Thunder and all them, you know, were killing it.
First times I met him in Germany, he told me, you know, you're pretty good, but you should learn how to do some footwork. And took his advice, and this is where I'm at now. EVO, Demon Smurf, you were a huge inspiration.
You know, he inspired a lot of people from Rock Force Crew back in the days when it was Reveal, Jeff, Nam, you know the group, and me. That nigga's the man. People didn't give it up to him like he should. He's amazing, you know, give him a special, I want to see him back in the game, putting it down.
EVO was actually one of the b-boys from England that could take some of us out from America. You know, he was actually iller than us first, you know, like EVO was someone we looked up to, and you know, he did a lot of like the double windmills and the, you know, the fast tracks and everything like that. And we, I actually seen a battle with him versus Ramine, was like a crazy battle, you know. So I think he could do power moves both ways, like halos, you know, both ways and stuff, which is crazy, you know. And yeah, he really had a good fast whip, and we just were really inspired by like what he did, you know. And it kind of made us what we do today possible.
The first time that like we seen Evo was actually off some footage from the Belfast City Breakers. Guys taught us, like old school guys, and they like told us about this English guy. Like, he was in Speed Machine, and he was just this amazing explosive b-boy.
They told us that they passed like a kind of philosophy on to us. And what they call b-boying is floor fighting. And what they say is like, every day you have to fight the floor. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. Sometimes the floor wins, you know what I mean?
I don't think Evo realizes how much people he has touched, how many people he's inspired, and basically, Jesus Christ, man, that one guy there, the demon himself, Jesus, the blur king, two ways doing this, to reverse go this way, spin that way, head spin, break it down, give the finger.
I started breaking in 1995 in a small village in Finland, and one of the first tapes that we saw, like, we were kind of isolated in this village. There was not really like b-boy scene in whole country at this time. And first tapes that we saw was like
Battle of the Year 1997,
Battle of the Year 97.
It was Judge Showcase.
Explosive. He had it all. Like, he had the power.
I was like, wow.
He had finesse. He had style.
That's crazy.
And he was also switching directions. He had dynamics. He got it all.
And you know, a lot of people in Russia was had a lot of inspiration from EVO.
I feel like I was at my peak in about 97, 98. I was fit, really fit, training all the time, touring with different groups and bands, going, you know, a few countries, and all the moves are flowing, the moves in your head. Moves were just coming from everywhere. The motivation was just all the dancers, competition, and just the reputation, keeping your reputation. What I always try to do when I throw down, I always try to throw a bit of everything into what I did, and always have something special in the combination which always stands out. Do something a little bit different in your top rock than when you hit the floor, you know, footwork. You change your speed as well. That's what I used to like doing. I used to like, you know, slow, fast, and your shape of your body as well. Make it big and then explode.
He's a small person like me.
He was really small, just like me.
So when he does his move,
so when he danced, like,
he makes you so big, like he's like
bigger than he was, like
7 foot, you know what I mean?
If you would watch footage on him, you would think he's like really tall
because of the explosiveness and stuff, you know what I mean?
You know, just his power, how fast he was with everything. So that's why I call him the little Tasmanian devil, because for me, like, I had mad respect for him over years just watching him. You know, watching him in the cyphers, watching him in the battles. You know, for me, you know, he's one of the top b-boys from UK. Or is the top b-boy from UK.
Once we practiced in Manchester, he asked me how to do air flare, and I can only do one, just from standing, you know what I'm saying? So I showed him, and he said, oh, in my days, we don't have a name for that. But we do that from windmill. And then he just bust a windmill air flare over my face. He was like, so I said, why do you want me to teach you? He said, no, you show me. I was just gonna see. You know what I mean? So I said to him, like, no, you're doing it like that. But I said, that's the air flare. So I said, yeah. And then from there, he just do every combination, from backspin to air flare, back to backspin, windmill air flare, headspin air flare, everything that you can think of, he's doing it. I was like, and he's asking me. I was like, no. And after that, I was like, yo, teach me some stuff.
It's a different way of describing him. Everything he could do, he seemed to be able to do both ways. You know, the style, even what he was doing then, now it looks like it's like right now, you know what I mean? And every great b-boy around the world who I've spoken to since has always name-checked him as one of their influences, whether it be Remind or Crumbs or, you know, any of the guys who've really made a big name over the last 10 years.
it's always a shock to be told that, you know, high class breakers like Ivan and, you know, these other guys in Storm, you inspired, you know, them. It's always flattering to know that, but them guys inspired me too. Swift, he sums up the word b-boy in his dance, in everything he does. He just so much style and flavor, and so much to look up to, like Nico from Throwdown Rockers as well. It's unbelievable, just so much style in what he does, in his footwork and his moves, his expressions, and a lot of that can be as good as power.
When I became an independent dancer, Nico asked me to join Throwdown. I said yeah, because I had a lot of respect for him and the other guys from Throwdown, as they did for me, and we liked each other's style.
They were just dope. They just didn't care, basically. They did their own thing. They took to me really quick. We just got on well. They invited me over to Sweden. It was for a brief time, but got a lot of style over there. Inspirations back in the day, obviously Street Machine, Broken Glass. One of the ones that stood out back then, Jason Orange, he was so smooth with his style. Just everything just flowed. It was just really good to watch.
Compared to everyone. Jason, you know, the guy, the speed, he could do what he was doing. And, you know, his runarounds, his wind, everything was perfect, you know, inch perfect. You know, there was no flaw in that guy's character whatsoever. And he was younger than us, so he was 13, 14 at the time.
Street Machine as well. He was way ahead of his time.
With Brian, he was just a workaholic. So he'd work on his moves solidly, and he was so smooth, you know, doing what he was doing. And he would be up there now with the best of them. I mean, he was in what was it, 85, when he won the championships.
I think that style, personally, I think some people have it more than others, because it's just their character. And if they display their character on the floor within their dance, it just comes out. What kind of impresses me from other b-boys is just things that are new, things that are different, and rather than the what you see a lot of, the showman moves, which is mainly your power. Don't get me wrong, I appreciate and respect power, but it does get a bit boring when you just see a guy doing 18 air flares or just go on and just jump into a head spin. You know, you need to see a little bit more style and flavour with it, and you know, more of a dance.
I don't think I've ever seen anybody in Europe again that had this philosophy about how to do power moves and how to go about it. You know, we were talking about it. I mean, you know, if we weren't dancing together, we were always talking about styles and how to improve and stuff. You know, and I just liked his philosophy of how to create all the dynamics within the power moves and within the combinations that he was using, you know, like certain techniques that was, you know, like for instance, he was saying that to do turtles and combine turtles with 90s, for instance, it would be a mismatch and stuff like that, which I completely agreed on, because it's just, you know, like it stops the flow and everything like that, you know. So we had a lot of common bases where we could talk on for days.
I love power and I love throwing it in. There's nothing more than hearing a crowd when you're in a circle and you pull out some power move. But it's always nice to be appreciated by the, you know, your dance side, your little flavour, the little bits that you throw in.
When I'm looking at Evo and his experience, you know, I think that he should pass it on to the new generation.
It's that dynamism coupled with just the change and just not knowing what's coming next. That feeling where you have your heart in the mouth. Will he do it? Will he do it? Will this come? Will that come? You know, where did that come from? It's all of that.
I don't think I've ever seen him like kind of kick off or be like really arrogant or anything. He just goes there, does his stuff, and that speaks for itself. He doesn't like talk his moves, he does his moves, you know what I mean?
He's even the old school, and it's like he just kind of he kept that format, but he perfected it so it was powerful enough to where when you watch it, it's like, dang, you know, he's gonna get applause anywhere. Like he can rock any crowd. Like that guy could probably rock a crowd of like 30,000 people just because with the speed of the stuff that he does and the and the difficulty, you know, he had a real high difficulty.
He had a little extra, you know. To me, it wasn't just like the power moves, because it was incredible, you know, power moves, transitions. But it was the originality in terms of the feel of his movement, you know, if you get what I'm saying. Like, it wasn't all kind of like he could just explode, but at the same time, he just kind of had some movements that would break it down, and it was had a lot of feeling, you know what I mean? And that's probably what appeals to me and to a lot of people about Evo and what makes him stand out.
When it goes to the footwork, it goes all the way to his back, under the knee, comes back, you know, switching directions.
I still watch footage nowadays and you see clips basically of guys from all over the world, and the young guy in my head still thinks I can compete with that stuff.
If Evo was on the scene nowadays, I think he would, like, what I seen, he would still just blow it up, still, like, roast a lot of people, myself included.
I think at the moment, it's very trendy to try to break the similar way as Evo did already 10 years ago, over 10 years ago. A lot of people are trying to have the same energy, the same feeling, and the same flavor as he did before. And I think nobody's getting there. So if Evo came back with the same stuff as he had before, he would kill it. No question.
come right out of Berlin, come out at the world scene now. I'll compare Evo's style to like a lyric that I've heard from Rakim. I've heard that the classic song, the Nas and KRS. Rakim has this flow, it's like timeless, because age don't count in the booth, because my flow stays submerged in the fountain of youth. And that, for me, depicts like a style that's classical, you know, it doesn't age. It doesn't matter if it's 20 years ago or in 20 years' time. What he does is his own and it's classic.
B-boy like Evo or other dancers of his generation that have kept going, Second to None, Born to Rock, etc. You know, they never really left their original format, if you like, the way that they approach the dance, even though there's a lot of influences nowadays. But those, that generation are very true of what the UK style is and what it should be. You know, we don't have to follow all these trends and different things that are coming over from overseas. We can maintain our own style and our own approach and still blow people away.
All of the hip-hop legends have the same thing in common. It's like, these styles are timeless. Like, if you watch some footage and no one told you the date of it, you'd think, all right, cool, like it's 2008 or 2020, 2000, whatever, you know, 3000. So that's what it's got. That's what all these people have. They've captured that kind of timeless style, you know?
When you threw your body into certain positions, I've never felt any sort of adrenaline like that from anything.
You got what you wanted. Now you don't want what you got. Once I was a field, then suddenly. Was it my mistake to give you everything I got? Now what you want me?
The world scene today just seems to have blown up. It's kind of a lot more in your face nowadays. The events are really glamorous. I decided to stop competing in 98, I think the last time I entered the UK Championships, because I just wasn't getting that buzz anymore from, I was pleasing the trying to please the crowd rather than please myself when I was on the stage. I was just going through the motions of doing it, and I feel when you don't buzz off that dance anymore, when you don't get them feelings of throwing down, then it's not coming across right, and you kind of start to do it for other reasons rather than the love of it. You're doing it for maybe money or something like that, and you just feel like it's like a job, and it shouldn't be a job, it's something you love to do.
I'd like to see him go out to the States, and you know, because I know the way that he'd be received out there, you know, because he's a legend, no doubt. And from the UK.
When I go to the United States now, there are so many people that just want to talk to me and want to, you know, they ask me about the past and what happened in Euro and how it, you know, like back from Battle of the Year to different jams that we appeared on, you know. And I wish that he would be there with me talking about all that stuff.
I'll tell you one thing as well, just for the record. I've been to Miami back in 2005. I was hanging out with Flipside Kings and I was hanging out with Mind 180. And man's all know him, like they all know Evo, you know what I mean? It's like Evo and Second to None. And people, whether they like to admit it or not, you know what I mean? He was one of a kind in terms of what he was doing back then, because people really went on that level. He's been an inspiration for people all over the world. I mean, I've traveled a lot with DJing, and people often ask me about EVO or Demon Smurf.
I've been traveling now for last 5 years around the world, and every time I say I'm from the UK, the people only say EVO's name, you know, Demon Smurf.
EVO's just phenomenal, man. Every time I'm in the States, it's like everyone says his name. Where's EVO? Where's EVO? Is he still dancing? From Kenny right down, everyone wants to know about EVO.
I wish that he would come back and he would actually, you know, like talk to Hooch, talk to other people, talk to other organizers, you know, so that he could also judge competitions and stuff, because his experience is needed. It's really needed, you know, his point of view is needed.
It'd be great to see him traveling to Korea and stuff like that, you know, because judging, exactly. I mean, I know that the R16, they're starting to pull out, like, you know, Ken Swift went out there last year and is going again this year, and Maurizio, and, you know, they're bringing in those old school legends from around the world. So, you know, I know that when I speak to him, he's like, oh, you know, I'm just doing my own thing, I'm keeping to myself, I'm not necessarily out there breaking. So it would be nice to see him at more jams, you know.
He's, you know, been recognised by Rocksteady, he's been recognised all over Europe, he's danced with, you know, everybody and anybody who's somebody, you know, everybody knows him, but he still kept himself to himself, and there's like a mystery to him.
Well, I've just received the Mighty Four Appreciation Award, which I was kind of honoured to receive, because it's kind of like an old b-boy that's been forgotten.
I got the privilege to sit down with Wiggles and Crazy Legs at the Rocksteady anniversary 2 years ago, and they were talking about, you know, possible names for the Spy Awards. And Wiggles was straight away, yo, what about that guy Evo? You know, straight away. Like, it was obviously they're looking after the US dancers. But, you know, he's up there, you know. When people talk about the greatest maybe of all time, you've got to put Evo in the top 10. Definitely.
Well, let's move swiftly on. Let me go to the next character. This guy here, back in the day, when things were dying in London, the scene in London was kind of low. We was looking for new inspirations, new b-boys to come through. When I saw this cat, fucking blew my mind. He was wearing all blue. He was moving, and I couldn't make out what the hell it was. I was like, what the fuck is this? It turned out that this little person was just a demon, aka Demon Smurf, Evo himself. This guy was phenomenal. He inspired a movement. It's like where Dolby left off, this guy came and he just took it to another level. He inspired so much people, he didn't even know he inspired. You know, I'm just honored and privileged that I can give this guy this award. So please, big it up for the one and only Evo.
As you can see, I don't really dance anymore, except when I'm really drunk at funerals and weddings. So just thanks, everybody. Thank you.
It's going to be good to look back and show my kids and stuff. They buzz off watching their old dad spinning round on the floor and just throwing down, which is great. That's more than made up for it. And you always end up providing still for your family.